If you are looking for all things real estate and an in-depth look at market fluctuations and answers to all your buying and selling questions, look no further than real estate expert Lisa Hill. Lisa brings her vast 15-year knowledge directly to you every week, sharing her own struggles as she navigates you through the twists and turns of the real estate world. Lisa has been sober for 9 years and has been motivating people ever since. A speaker, mentor, and teacher. Each week, Lisa will welcome guests from all facets of the industry to ensure you are as informed as possible before making any real estate decisions. This is the Lisa Hill Show, real estate for the real world.
Hey, 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 everybody. This is the Lisa Hill Show, real estate for the real world. I am your host, Lisa Hill, and we have such an exciting show today. I have Carrie Nikolsky here. She is a mortgage expert. She's going to be talking about VA loans. And, you know, it's so funny. We're talking before the show and we're doing most of our talking before. And I'm like, wait a minute, Carrie. I'm like, we need to record this. All right. We're talking ahead of time. So welcome, Carrie. Welcome to the show.
Happy to be here, Lisa. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you so much for coming on. So the topic today is going to be how to use your VA loan. So it's for all active duty service members and all of our veterans out there. And this topic is especially important to me because, well, it's close to home. I'm a Navy family. My boyfriend is active duty Navy chief. And so it's really close to home. And Carrie comes from a military family as well. And it's really important that we educate all of our veterans out there and our active duty service members how they can buy a house with no money down. And so Carrie is the VA expert, and I don't use the word expert lightly. And so she's just amazing. We're going to get to that in just a minute. So I start out my shows normally with the email or question of the week. And so I've been working on it all this week because I, for some reason, had a ton, probably because of the podcast, but a ton of questions. So what I was going to do this week was like a compilation of multiple questions. And instead, what happened today is there's a post on Facebook and I make my comment, I give my 2 cents, and it's this huge thread. There's like 31 plus comments. The comments are still coming in. But it was like turned into this debate. Okay. And it's about credit. Someone asked a question about credit and the responses were just like absurd. And it really was concerning. And those of you out there that know me know that if I'm passionate about something, like I'm not a big debater. I don't post political stuff. Or I'm not like, you know, big on, you know, what religion. I'm pretty like, you know, open-minded and even and oh, whatever. So I'm not one to debate on something unless I feel super, super passionate about it. So I was like firing off. I think this is literally the only like Facebook or social media debate I've ever got into. But it's really, really important to me. So I'm going to read you guys. And Carrie, since you are the mortgage expert, I want you to chime in also. So listeners out there, Carrie doesn't know what I'm going to say right now, and I have a feeling of what her reaction is going to be. So, okay, and then the person who posted this, he private messaged me because I was getting real super heated on the post, and we talked about it, and he's like, please share it. Absolutely. So I told him that it's going to be on the podcast today. So here is the question. He says, I need advice. Do I pay my car off in full or leave about a year's worth of payments on it to build credit? I've had the car 8 months. So some of the responses were kind of shocking. So the first one says, I think it depends whether you intend to maintain a FICO score. If you do not use or apply for credit, you're completely out of debt and your score will disappear and go to zero after about 6 months. You can qualify for a home mortgage, but you will not qualify with a low score. Okay, Carrie's laughing over here.
Interesting, because you know when it does come to FICO and it comes to credit history, we do look at previous credit history to figure out what someone is going to do if they are applying for a mortgage. So you are looking for some type of history.
Yeah.
So I'm sure you got like 30. You said 30 different responses to this poor guy.
Yeah, I did, and most of them. So. That was one response. And you know, he said, I think it depends on whether you intend to keep a FICO score. Well, unless you plan on, and I mean this honestly, and I don't mean this, my comments to come off as like mean spirit or anything, but like, if you intend to keep a FICO, unless you're moving to the woods and you don't intend on like being a consumer in the world, you probably do want to maintain a FICO.
You do. Very few people don't have a score.
Yeah.
So they have some kind of footprint.
And a score is a credit reputation. Mm-hmm. It's like your reputation. That's exactly what it is. If I loan you this money, you're going to pay me back. It's like, you know, you walking down the street and you see a stranger and they're like, hey, Lisa, you know, loan me $20. I'm like, well, I don't know who you are. I'm not going to loan you $20. And there's a relative that's like, hey, Lisa, will you loan me $20? I'm like, okay, well, they borrowed $20 last month. They paid me on time. They borrowed $20, you know, a year ago, and they paid me back on time. I'll probably loan them $20. That's credit. A family member that, hey, can I borrow $20? Well, you didn't pay me last month and you paid me late before. That's I'm not going to loan it to you again. That's what credit is for. It's right. Your reputation. It's your ability to repay. So you do want to maintain a FICO.
It also is indicative when you're looking at the FICO score. And I don't know if I've talked to you about this, Lisa. It shows character.
It does.
There are people that have the capacity, but if they don't have the character, you may not get paid whether they have the money or not. Yeah. So if you have somebody that has an isolated event, and whether it's a divorce or a death or an illness, and they paid perfectly prior to and since then, hey, that person's going to pay you.
Yes.
Because they just had an isolated event. If you've had somebody that's just they've had credit problems their whole life,
forever,
then yeah, that's pretty much how they're going to pay you.
Exactly.
So it's not just about the one trade, I think is what you're saying.
Yeah.
It's he should have other credit established.
Exactly. So then the post goes on to say the next comment says, your score will go higher if you pay it off in full. So if you're ever trying to get another loan, it will show you made payments on time and then paid in full when you could. So that's not necessarily true. Your score doesn't increase when you pay it off, pay something off. So that's not true. And then another comment says, pay it off. You already established credit. You want to be debt free. Don't be a slave to the lender. You want to pay everything in cash. No.
No, you don't, because installment debt is looked at different from revolving debt, first mm-hmm. of all. And since this is an auto, and if he pays more than the minimum, or if he pays every month, that's going to be a great credit reference, and that will help his FICO score. And like we were saying, if you have a lot of other credit cards, but you don't utilize 100% of the credit limit, then you're going to have a good credit score. It's when you max out everything that yeah. you have and you pay the minimum and you think you're going to have a good score. No, that's not the case, because you're utilizing 100% of your credit limit.
Exactly.
So,
yeah, and there's and I pulled it up on Forbes today about the factors that determine your credit score. And because I sent tons of links on this particular thread because we use three credit bureaus, Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion, to pull credit. So I pulled up resources from all of the credit bureaus and I posted them on the thread. I'm like, here you go, like research. Don't take my word for it. Also check into the source. Go directly to the source. And so I sent over like all of the links, and there's five factors that determine your score. Is the payment history. The debt to credit utilization is what you were talking about.
Exactly.
So you want to keep it 30% or below.
Or lower.
Yeah. Right. So for the listeners out there, for example, if you have like a $500 credit limit, keep it at $150 or below the limit, using only 30% of what you can. So that's one of the factors, is the credit to the limit utilization. So also length of credit history. A credit mix, so the different types of credit that you have, and new credit, which can affect it as well. So continuing on with the post, again, most of them, what we have here is most people were telling him to pay it off. Pay it off. Someone put on here, his comment says, it's good to have a paid off loan on your credit, even better than the monthly payments. So that person, they thought that a paid off auto on their credit would be better than showing monthly payments.
Right, because they're thinking, okay, it's better just to be out of debt. That's kind of yeah. the mindset for most people is if I'm out of debt, that's a good thing.
Exactly.
And I understand why there's the misconception or just misinformation, but that's not what he asked. He asked about maintaining his FICO score.
Correct.
So that if you have everything paid off and you have no credit, then that's counterintuitive because you're not going to be able to show how you pay.
Exactly.
So you do have to have credit established. That doesn't mean you have to be in debt. And I think that's where the
exactly
I guess people get confused.
Yeah, there's a difference between debt and credit.
Right. And they're well intended, but it's the advice that isn't going to help you.
It's exactly. I think the best comment on here, someone said, you know, for advice, she said, my advice is don't take advice from random people on Facebook. Right. I'm like, this is the best piece of advice that you could give on
and
here.
And that's about anything. People share all kinds of interesting stuff about their life and ask, basically soliciting advice.
Yeah.
Over every aspect.
And there were missing factors also. So he private messaged me because I sent a bunch of research. Actually, let me get back to this really quickly. So the guy that posted it's better to, you know, it's better than even your monthly payments reporting. So I sent the link, right, about that, how it doesn't necessarily help your credit to do that. And his comment back, this makes me happy because this is the reason why I was doing it, because I wanted to insert my knowledge into everybody's brain and say, okay, here's what I know about it. And here's why people have, you know, financial literacy we're not taught in school. People don't know personal finance. It's not taught in our curriculum.
It's not exactly sexy or exciting.
No, it's not.
It's not. So they're not going to read up on it at night unless they're trying to cure insomnia.
Exactly. So, and even then, the retention of that and the comprehension, unless you're self-taught almost or
you have to have a very good reason. If it's a job related, you have to know this information.
Yes.
Or maybe you've been burned and you don't want to be burned again.
Yeah,
then you'll read up on it. Other than that, why would you know? Yeah. Why should you?
So his comment says, so I send over the link and his comment says, guess who's checking their credit score now, ! This thread is a positive reinforcement. I was like, hell yes.
Well,
mission accomplished.
It is.
If I can help, that's what I would say. If I can help one person, if one person can learn from something that I know and mistakes I've seen on people's credit reports and what people think and how it hurts them when you're trying, especially when you're trying to do good. Like, I know all the people that were commenting on this were helping him out.
They were well-intended.
Yes.
They were trying, they thought what they were giving him was really sound advice, and because they're thinking in terms of debt, not credit.
Yeah.
So the other thing is when people are trying to increase their score, their FICO score, because I do this every day all the time, mm-hmm. people trying to get into a house and maybe they're trying to not just qualify but get into some kind of a down payment assistance, which is FICO driven.
Yeah.
The first thing we do is pay down a credit card.
Yes.
Because that's going to
pay
make
down
your score.
Exactly.
And that's what I was talking about, the utilization of credit. And of course, I tell them you would think it would be pay on time. Don't you know, let even one bill slip by.
Yeah.
Don't go out and buy a new car while we're trying to get through this escrow. I have to be very, very kind of like hit them over the head, because
yeah.
people really do want to buy furniture, or they'll see a good deal and then they want to go to Macy's and get 20% off, and then you have a hard inquiry on your credit.
Yeah.
And that's a
and
hard
inquiry.
And they
do it. And people,
well, yeah, because they're not thinking in terms
yeah.
of, oh, this is really going to hurt my score.
Yeah. To reiterate, because I know on the loan side, when my clients, you know, you do the finance part, you do the real estate side of it. When my new buyers, I give them an opening packet and I have the 10 commandments
mm-hmm. oh, I love
of
it.
Applying for a loan, because we have to sometimes, like I said, we're not taught this in school.
No.
So sometimes you have to
scare them.
You have to scare them.
I scare them. That's what I do.
And hear it a few times. Like your realtor's telling you this and your loan officer, do not don't buy stuff on credit.
Right.
Don't go get a new car. Don't quit mm-hmm. your job.
Don't do anything different than you have done.
Don't even sneeze
right.
unless you ask one of us.
Well, and they also have to understand that if they think they're going to try to pull one over on us, I always say we will find out.
Yeah.
I mean, it almost sounds
like
we're the
with
government.
You.
Like, look, we're going to find out if you go out and charge up your credit cards. I'm going to get an alert and I'm going to be told from the underwriter that you charged up all this debt, and we're going to know, and it's going to be at funding. and you're not going to be able to buy your
house.
You're
not going to get your keys.
And unless you have the money to pay off that debt prior to close, you're not going to be a homeowner, and it's going to happen right at the end. Yeah. So don't do that.
It's good to scare them sometimes.
It's effective. If I am not very explicit, then they tend to think that my instruction is kind of open to interpretation.
Yeah.
Well, we were almost closed escrow. Well, that's not closed escrow. Yeah. So now we have a problem. Houston, we have a big problem. So anyway,
thank you so much for the insight on that. And I knew that you would be the perfect person to be on the show when this came up. So thank you. And I hope that answered everyone's questions out there about credit specific. So switching gears now to our topic, which is VA loans. Okay. For our active duty service members and our veterans. So Carrie, tell me a little bit about your background and experience and how you became the VA expert that you are today.
Okay, I did not start out the VA expert. So it was something that, I guess, just like when you're going through life, you decide, okay, I need to do this one thing because it's basically going to make me money and I need a job. Mm-hmm. So it was one of those situations where when I started in finance, I mean, I have a finance degree, but again, I kind of backed into that too. And So when I got into the real world, it was just in finance and banking. And I did enjoy doing it. And I don't think I would want to do anything else if I had to try and go out.
And you're really good at it.
And you just have to really understand how the business works. And then you also have to care about people.
Yes.
And you have to care that they're scared and that this is their life savings and that a lot of people's paychecks, you know, including the realtors, are riding on this, my own included.
Yes.
But that's not the first and foremost for me. Is my checking account will take care of itself if I take care of all these other people.
Exactly. Yeah.
And you got to do it in that order. That's how I look at it. But as far as VA, I've been in the business, finance and banking and during some type of either wholesale or retail lending, I want to say for about 25 years, but I almost don't want to say that. So because then I could say I started in the business when I was 10 with Lisa. But I guess it really has been that long because time does fly in our line of work.
It does.
And with that time.
Because we've known each other for 15 years.
Right. So it had to have been longer than 15, right? So for me, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So, so it's been a little bit longer. But with that time comes experience and a lot of knowledge. Like you were saying, you want to be able to share what you know with people.
Yes.
So that you can help them.
Yeah. And I feel like that's why we align, because I feel a duty. Like I feel a duty to inform people.
Right.
I am on like a mission to share information from my experiences because I feel like I'm called to do that. And
compelled to do it.
You
do.
And you're the same way. You're like, they are going to get in this house. Come hell or
high
water.
I jump in the trenches with them. I tell them we're almost like we're married. I don't want to scare people, but I'm like, okay, we're married until this is done.
Yeah.
And I advise them on what I think they should do. Ultimately, I tell them it's up to them, but I do give them my just from my own experience and as far as buying homes and then also my experience in my career, mm-hmm. what I think is the best course of action depending on their circumstances and situation. So as far as the VA, when the whole economy went bust mm-hmm. up here, 2007, 2008, you and I, we both remember those days.
Oh, yeah.
So,
we had a deal funding and you called and said, the bank closed.
We're done. Yeah. Overnight, 24 hours. Yeah. And I've been with them for almost 10 years.
Yeah.
So, and they were always saying how stable they are.
I'm like, what do you mean, Carrie, that we're done? There's no bank. The bank is gone.
They said that they were, and we were, I think there was some higher ups, like, vacationing
in
or
in
yes so yeah. it was not a good time. So anyway, long story short, my job went away and it was one of those where we all have to reinvent ourselves, and I wanted to stay in doing loans because I really do enjoy doing them. I mean, it's something that I do well because I enjoy it. And I just, if you have a God-given gift for it and you know you can help people and then you have their best interest at heart, then like you said, you're really duty-bound to do it.
You are.
And it's a tough job.
It is.
It is. The only thing tougher than this job is being a mother. And that is the hardest job in the whole world.
Oh, your daughter. So, she's a cakewalk, I'm sure.
She's
a little you.
She is, and then she's got red hair. Mm-hmm. So, but it's so rewarding. And so with this job, I have a sister and a brother-in-law who were former military, and they got into the line of work because I was in the line of work. Mm-hmm. And she was a CPA, and she saw my taxes, and she said, I got to, you know, if you can do it, I can do it, because that's my sister.
Yeah.
And and so I said, you absolutely can do it. And, but she noticed that there was a, as far as like the veterans, there really wasn't anybody helping them. And so she wanted to set up something just for them. And she noticed that the VA loans were not being utilized.
They're not. They're completely underutilized.
And
completely.
Especially during that time.
Yeah.
During that time, there weren't people catering to the military at all.
No.
And
the reason why, I'll explain to the listeners out there on the real estate part of it, there's certain things that – there's certain VA, like allowables or non-allowables, that the government puts in place to protect the veteran. And – the realtors don't want to sometimes, I guess, put up with it.
They don't want to deal with it.
And it takes, right. It's not that much more work.
No.
But people who don't understand and are not educated about it, they say, oh, it's extra paperwork. We don't want to do it. Oh, just put them into a conventional. I'll put them into an FHA. And it's like, no, if you can use your VA benefits, use it. It pisses me off when I have a VA buyer, mm-hmm. and I'm showing property and they say no VA. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, can you, and I call them, can you explain to me why?
Right. Clarify.
Can you please clarify why you are not allowing the people who protect our country,
who sacrifice,
right. why you're excluding them? Can you explain to me that?
Right. You have to have somebody going to bat for them. And you have to have not only the knowledge, but you have to have the courage. You have a lot of scared people that are afraid to just call up the listing agent.
Yeah, and they'll probably be scared after they hear from me.
Well, yeah. Well, you'll make an impact. And you know what, though? That works, though, because I've called up many a listing agent.
For me, yes, you have.
And I've called and said, this isn't going to go conventional because it doesn't need to go conventional. Because if we are outbid because it's a market and we didn't get that house because that's just how the market played out, fine. But if you're saying that you don't want our business because it's a VA, that's a tragedy because you are working under a misconception that our offer is somehow less than, and that is not the case. I'm sorry if you've had previous bad experience. I realize I don't want to poo-poo that because it's had its problems in the past with you had the closing that were 60 days, you had a lot of paperwork, and you had real, you know, the appraisals maybe not appraising. Those are really the old days.
Yeah.
And those,
it's lack of understanding and lack of people wanting to use it because of extra paperwork. So loan officers, so we have it like a twofold. Loan officers will say, oh no, we're not going to use your VA because they don't know how. Sometimes they do not
know
how.
They don't
know,
and they're scared. Honestly, they're afraid of getting into something that is going to, if it's your listing agent, you're afraid you're going to somehow screw over your seller.
Yeah, exactly. And the realtors, they're not knowledgeable about it as well. So they just, nobody wants to deal with it, which is so unfortunate because it's like, why would you not? It's like, oh, well, we don't want to deal with you. Sorry, you protect our country. But we don't
want
to.
But money is money, and we want this deal to close, and we don't want any problems.
Yeah, no.
So, and what they don't understand is there doesn't have to be problems. You can address any concerns up front, which I usually try to do. And then you also want to remind them that this person did sacrifice for the country. Mm-hmm. And I understand that, you know, that isn't necessarily what we're hanging our hat on solely, but you don't want to discount it either.
Exactly. Don't discount it.
And it's discounted so easily.
Exactly.
When it comes to money. And it's like, you can still make your money, and our offer is still just as good as anybody else's, and we can address any concern you have. We can eliminate the surprises that you would normally get right up front by addressing the non-allowables, by addressing the fact that the appraisals thanks to the Tidewater Initiative, if they have an appraised value that's not coming in at value, that VA appraiser has to call me, and he asks for comps.
Yeah.
And then if we have 2 days to get the comps, 2 business days, if they're not there, then the value's not there. They don't want the veteran paying more than the market value,
which should be an incentive for any buyer anyways.
Right.
You know, if it's not worth that, well, hey, it's not worth that. You're paying more for something.
Right. And the agents usually know it.
Yeah.
And so the main point is that they're going to call you before their report is done. And the reason that's so important is because if you've ever tried to get an appraiser to change his mind after the fact, whether it's conventional FHA or VA, good luck with that.
Yeah.
He's going to wait 2 days, get the additional comps. And I've had the values come in higher.
Good.
In the past. Good. So the value's coming in low. Again, I don't see that happening. And then you also have to address, okay, if there are repairs, well, the veteran can pay those repairs.
Yeah.
They just can't pay for the report.
Yeah.
So all those things that they're concerned about, the VA non-allowables usually can get covered with a small seller credit or even a lender credit.
Yeah.
They don't necessarily have to be on the hook for thousands of dollars at the end.
Yeah. So you said you started in with your sister and your brother-in-law, because yes, they were Navy as well.
They were Navy. They were both Navy, and they started a business right as the economy tanked, mm-hmm, and almost went out of business. So they were not, an overnight success, so to speak. Nobody wanted to deal with them because they were doing the VA loans.
Yeah.
But once the market tanked, then you had a couple of things happen. You had the market in San Diego come down enough to where it matched the VA loan limit. Before, that had not happened before. The VA held really low loan, mm-hmm, limits, and so the market was pretty much shut out.
Underutilized.
And it was. So you had all these veterans that were shut out of the market in San Diego. And then you had the VA increase the loan limit, and you had the market prices come down, so it made the housing more affordable. And then you had every other lender that was doing the 100% loan to value leave the market overnight.
Yes.
We were just talking about my company overnight.
Yeah.
So now you have this one loan that's never changed, that's always been the same, because the VA, that's the joke, they really don't change that much.
Yeah.
And you had realtors flocking to them to learn how to do VA, because every other person down there is a VA, whether they're married to it or they're in the military. Yeah. So it was definitely in the realtor's best interest to reinvent themselves, mm-hmm, and now listen to what they had to say.
Yeah. And so you went down there. So you moved down there in the midst of it. And that's how you got the specialty of VA, because that's all that we were doing. That's all the loans that were going on.
Right.
And so you got...
Well, I had to learn how to do them.
Part of it.
Yes, because she said get licensed. And then it was supposed to be come down here for 2 weeks. I was there for 6 months, mm-hmm, not realizing how much I had to learn. And those loans were the most rewarding, because these were guys that were on the battlefield. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, they don't make a lot of money, and they all have families. Mm-hmm. And so it was a great feeling to be working and helping these guys. Yeah. So I was like, okay, God, I can feed my own family. Yeah. So I'm working,
yeah,
because it was about survival back then for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to be able to come back and do a good job. And I wasn't even sure if I was going to stay up here, because I still didn't have a job up here. Mm-hmm. And I didn't really have, I mean, other than, I didn't have family. I had a house, and I thought, well, should I sell it, or should I stay, or should I go? And I decided to stay.
Glad that you
and
did.
And I'm so glad I did.
Yeah.
I'm so glad I did.
So then you picked up that niche.
Picked it up, because I realized how much it was needed up here.
Yeah, absolutely.
We were way behind up here.
Yeah, because we don't have a base here.
We have a lot of veterans that live here.
Yes,
though.
A lot of veterans.
And they need those loans just as badly. And they were being shut out of the market, or that, like you said, they were also being told you need to go into a conventional or FHA by the listing agent. How dare a listing agent dictate to a veteran how he's going to finance his house?
Yeah.
And that's the way you got to do it. You got to go to bat for them, even if it means, hey, they may not take your offer.
Yeah. Well, so for all the listeners out there, if you're an active duty service member or a veteran out there, utilize your VA. And if you're working with a different realtor in a different area, make sure that they go to bat for you. Make sure that they understand that, and don't be pushed into a different type of loan. If you choose different financing, fine, but don't be swayed in a different direction.
Don't be dictated to.
Yes.
And know that they are just operating under the misconception of the VA of 20, 30 years ago. Or they're, like Lisa was saying, they just don't want to be bothered.
Yeah.
So, but that's your mortgage. You're going to pay not only mortgage insurance, which you shouldn't have to because VA doesn't require mortgage insurance. You're going to have to be putting a lot of money down. And it's not necessary. That VA was meant for you because you've earned it and you should have it. And it's a great loan. I can close loans in 30 days or less. We're closing escrow right now.
We just closed one. Yeah, we're closing escrow right now. Yeah.
And it's if you know how to close them, if you have a, the key is to know how to close them.
So let's share this story a little bit. So we have active duty Navy. She's moving into the area.
Right.
I referred her over to you. And when was that? We've closed in, it'll be about 30 days.
It's about a 30-day close. It'll be 30 days. And I think it wasn't, maybe we started talking to her in January?
The end of January.
Okay,
so.
Right. And she was pre-approved with another lender.
Mm-hmm.
And Lisa, you referred her. I appreciate
referrals. She said, I got an online. I'm like, no. I can't. I need Carrie. I can't have an online company. I can't do it. I have to have somebody who I know is going to close it. That will close it on time.
And you don't have to worry. You know that if I have it, you don't have to worry.
You're going to be in the trenches with me.
I stay in with them. Well, yeah. And I want the buyer to trust me and to know that I am sincere. And usually when I have my first call with them, something comes across through the phone and they trust me.
Yeah.
They just go with their gut.
Well, they should.
And they listen to their gut.
Yes.
And I don't think I have people, I can't even name one that has ever left me because they decided they couldn't trust me. I just don't have it.
Yeah,
They're something that comes across either in my voice or the way that I'm talking to them.
Yeah.
That I'm sincere and that
because,
you gotta be confident.
You tell the truth. You say, okay, we can close it in this time frame, which we have, which she'll move here when she transfers and she'll have her keys waiting for, which is great. Right. And she actually didn't come in with any money down.
No, she had no money. She is
zero.
Yes. And you know, when you're moving and you are just having all these other expenses because you're traveling, you don't have a lot of extra money. And she was definitely one of those. And so I was telling Lisa, let's get her in with having the seller cover her closing, and then the VA loan will cover all of, you know, the purchase of the house.
Yep.
And so she's coming in and she's getting some
money back. Right.
She had a little earnest money deposit that she put in, and she's getting some of that back. So she's not having to come in with anything at close of escrow.
Nothing.
And she's very happy.
Yeah.
So
wow. So she got into it under $1,000.
Right. And I had to do when she was out buying and looking for property, as you know, Lisa, she was looking in a lower price point. Mm-hmm. Not that she couldn't afford a higher one, but she was wanting to make sure that she could afford the mortgage payment. Mm-hmm. And then in this case, it was some homeowners association fees.
Yeah.
So you just have to really talk it through with people.
Yes.
Ultimately, it's their decision, but you want to let them know you can more than afford it. You wouldn't have been able to get an approval, and you're going to be a homeowner, and you're going to lock in a low rate, and you're going to be in 5 years, it's a great investment vehicle as well as a place to live.
Absolutely.
As opposed to renting and paying down somebody else's mortgage while you're here.
Exactly. Yeah, so it makes perfect sense. So I want to give the listener some, we're running over, Carrie, because we're chatty. We always, our lunch is 2 hour long.
Exactly. And we, you know, don't look at the clock. So
I have to schedule. I'm like, oh.
Well, and I thought, I honestly thought 30 minutes is a long time. I hope I don't run out of things to say.
Oh, no.
I actually was worried about that.
No. We're going a little over, but that's fine. But I want to tell, I want you to tell the listeners out there some of the benefits using the VA. So we talked a little bit about, before we started recording, mm-hmm. about past credit history.
Right.
So what are some of the exceptions that the VA will allow as in regards to derogatory credit?
Okay, so the VA is probably the most liberal when it comes to prior derogatory or credit that is less than stellar or a ding, such as a foreclosure, bankruptcy, short sale, which given the last 7 years, there's a lot of people that fall under that umbrella that never did before.
Yeah.
So typically it's just 2 year seasoning.
Okay.
On any one of those. Any other loan requires more seasoning. So that right there, if you've got 2 year seasoning, then you may be a candidate to get a VA loan. We talked about like the prior foreclosures. I had a veteran that had a foreclosure and it was on a VA loan. And he didn't think he could get another VA loan because his foreclosure wasn't just a foreclosure, but it was on his VA eligibility. The funny thing is if you've had a prior foreclosure and it's with your VA, you may still be able to get another VA loan. You just can't, like in this case, he couldn't go the normal county limit, which at the time was the 417, mm-hmm. but he could go to 300,000 with zero down. He just couldn't go to 417.
So he still qualified.
So he still qualified, and all this time, he didn't think that he could.
So
and
he's been renting.
He had been, and he was trying to do a quote-unquote fresh start. He was crying when we closed his loan, and his life was just taking a turn for just much a better road because he had gone through so much, the foreclosure just being one of the things that had happened to him. And now he's
a homeowner.
He's a homeowner and he couldn't thank me enough. And that's very rewarding because anybody else looking at his certificate of eligibility when it showed he had zero entitlement, Lisa, zero. Wow. And so I called the VA we got. We found out he could still lend. So the other thing is jumbo loans. I wanted to mention on the VA, we can do the large loan amounts. I know that not just in the San Joaquin area, but also in California, loan limits are a big deal. And with the home prices skyrocketing.
What's the jumbo loan limit for a VA?
So we have the conforming, you have the normal conforming 424, but you can go over that. And it's a jumbo loan. It's considered like a high balance VA loan. And the key there though is you can go over the conforming loan limit of 424 in our county, and you don't have to put the normal down payment that you would for a conventional loan. So for example, with a conventional loan, if you had to put $100,000 down, because you were $100,000 over the limit on you only have to put $25,000 down for a VA, and there's no MI, and the rates are good. So that's why knowing that the VA does do the large loans, the jumbo loan sizes. It's just a good, to me, it's great to know, especially for those pockets like Tracy and even in Lodi, where you see the loan sizes basically going over the conforming loan limit, and then you don't have to come in with all this money down like you would on a conventional.
Yeah, that's really great. So what is some, we do have a lot of, in addition to the normal consumers that listen to this podcast, we also have a large listeners of realtors. What advice would you give to realtors who have veteran clients or that are using the or that want to use their VA? What advice would you give the realtors in regards to like maybe how to write up the offer or how to do it? What's some advice? Because you always tell me how to write up what to write.
I
in
do.
The offer.
You basically up front, you want to address who's paying for the VA non-allowables, and those are just closing costs that the veteran absolutely cannot pay. They usually run about, I want to say, $1,500 on average.
Okay.
And sometimes you can get the lender under a lender credit, but you want to address it in the offer because you don't want a seller to be on the hook in the 11th hour. I wouldn't want that if I were a seller and as a listing agent. So you do want to address, okay, who's paying for the non-allowables?
Okay.
And you got to put upfront too with a listing agent, hey, my veteran can't pay for the termite report, but repairs are negotiable. Doesn't mean your VA buyer will.
Yeah.
It just means that they can.
Yeah.
So that puts the seller more at ease, and you can also put a cap on the repairs.
Yeah.
So those are the kind of things that you want to talk about. As far as the emotional side, if you're in a very tough market and you're going up against a lot of offers and it is a seller's market, you're going to want to talk about the maybe include pictures in a letter or something that shows the life and times about this veteran while they served in the military, because you want to hit an emotional chord with that seller.
Yes.
And that will go a long way.
That does matter.
If they have a husband or a son or somebody that is in the military, they may, it may not be the highest and best, but they want that single mom that's a veteran to get this house.
Yeah.
And so that's why that's important to
I added that in our last offer.
It matters.
Yeah.
Because the emotional.
She's active duty Navy, moving here by herself. We need to get her into this. We need to. And she accepted our offer. So.
Right. Well, so, and that happens. I mean, you will see a seller that you might resonate with the seller, especially if it's a house that they really, really love. And we're trying to stand out.
Yeah. That's the thing. Always emotional. I mean, it always
buying a house is emotional. Buying a car is emotional.
And selling a house too.
So
it's always emotional. And it's funny because, believe it or not, I have my sellers more often than not will ask who's buying it. Why, in considering offers. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is one of the factors when they do.
They do. They want to know who's going to live in this house. They want to. It's almost like they need to see you, picture you living in the house.
Yeah, and
you know?
I had a listing, and we just went into contract with the buyer. I don't know the buyer, but my seller, he's like, well, I checked him out on Facebook.
Yeah.
He went on Facebook, like, checked him out, and was like, and him and his
he
wife.
He seems like a good guy.
They consider like, okay, yeah, they could live here.
Right.
Yeah.
He passes. Well, and another thing I would tell the realtors is the lender matters. If you're going to just an online or just a regular bank, you know, the perception of the lender in the field matters. If you have a good reputation, if you're known for closing on time, obviously that's going to help get your offer accepted. If they've never heard of you, if you're out of state,
because
not
as a
so
listing
much.
Agent, if I
you
see
don't
a want lender, to
see that. Yeah, you look for the lender. Do you not?
How
important is that?
That's the probably
that's
one
the
most
important thing. No, you have, even though the buyers don't understand how important it is, you have to communicate that to your buyer. That the lender controls 80-90% of the transaction. What does that tell you?
I would say more, because you have the money. At the end of the day,
no
if
pressure.
If the lender
Lisa,
says
no,
if the lender says right. well, if the lender says no, then you have no deal. Then
right.
we do not have a deal.
Right.
So and the lender, I would say it's more.
It's a high pressure job. Let's just put it that way.
Because we can negotiate. I can negotiate anything in my deal.
Right.
You know, in my contract stuff. I'm like, okay, we'll pay for this. We're not going to pay for that. The price is this. The
right.
repairs are negotiable. We'll throw in these upgrades. We won't in here. I'll give you this money. I can negotiate pretty much, you know, anything within the contract. The money, the lender, there are no. You have your FICO is your FICO. Your
right.
income is your income. There is none. You fit into this is the box of,
right.
of approval. And if it's not, then
most of the time it is a black and white issue, and you should know up front. That's why the lender's important. Does this buyer have the credit, the income, the assets to purchase this house before they ever go looking? And you have to make sure that all that's done before you send out that pre-approval letter. So not everybody does that. They'll just pull a credit report and take their information over the phone, and then you get a pre-approval letter, and the buyer's on their way thinking that they can get a $300,000 house.
Yeah.
So one other thing I wanted to mention is the flip properties. I don't know how many of them there are these days. But,
few, but there's some.
But if
they're
are,
still out there.
The VA loves those. They tend to shy away from the fixer-uppers because they are kind of co-owning with 100% loan-to-value. They want to make sure the house is marketable. And unlike FHA, there aren't any overlays for flip.
Okay.
So if you've got...
there's no restrictions.
I had one that's closing this month. It's a flip. And the FHA buyer, he got into contract and had to get right back out because... Sorry, you know, you can't. Now, his mom, who is VA, I said, your mom could buy the house, but you can't.
See,
so.
That right there. How did you know his mom had a VA? Because you probably asked.
Because, he's buying and so is she at the same time.
Yeah.
So mom referred her son to me.
Yeah.
And then he ended up getting into contract before her. But I knew that she could buy the house and he couldn't.
Yeah.
Because of the type of loan.
Nice. So you're asking questions and you're trying to
a lot of questions.
Figure out
I ask a lot
how you can get the deal done. Yes. Like, how can we?
They have to tell me every skeleton in their closet. So I tell them it's like doctor, patient, or client, yeah. attorney, client privilege. I'm not allowed to say anything, but I do need to hear everything because we don't want to find out in the 11th hour something that you didn't tell me and an underwriter finds it and I didn't know about it. I mean, it really is like that.
Yeah.
So okay. they do pretty much, they do try to tell me and then, you know.
Yeah, they don't tell me anything, which is fine. they tell you everything. They're yeah. like, I love this kitchen. I love this house.
Right. They just want to buy it.
I'm like, right. okay, great. And then it's,
let's,
you know.
Let's write up the offer.
You get all the skeletons. I'm like.
I get everything.
Unless I need to know the dirt.
Right.
Or if and you want to tell me, that's
it
fine.
Is,
but.
Because it is not necessarily someone's finest hour. They weren't on a winning streak when the skeletons happened.
Yeah.
So you don't want to always broadcast, oh, I had a divorce, or oh, I had a foreclosure, or I had a bankruptcy. But they can tell me.
Yeah.
And they need to feel
they need to feel
safe that they can do that and not feel judged like they might at a bank, you know, not feel like, oh, you're not worthy. No, that's
where
not
they,
the case.
Where they stamp and say not approved.
Exactly.
And, yeah.
Right. So that's definitely not the reason that I need the information. I need the information so that
you can work for them.
I can make it so that there's nothing that's going to keep us from purchasing this house once you find the house you love.
Yeah.
So.
Exactly. Okay, Carrie, thank you so, so, so much. I had a great time with you today. And can you let the listeners out there know how to reach you, how to contact you, what your contact information is?
Sure. I work for Stearns Lending, and my cell phone, 209-639-3330, or you can email me at C. Nicholsky, C-N-I-C-H-O-L-S-K-Y at Stearns.com. So at Stearns.com.
Okay. And I'll put your information up on our website as well. That way they can contact you. Again, thank you so much. And you guys tune in next week. We have another great show up. And if you didn't tune in last week, go back and listen. All right.
Thanks for stopping by the Lisa Hill Show. For more information, please visit LisaHillTeam.com. Catch us on the next episode when Lisa brings you more real estate for the real world.